Father, we want to thank you for the blessings of being in your house. And Lord, we pray for a great spiritual blessing today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Morning, everybody. Happy Sabbath. Yeah. They said not to touch your face. You put this on and you breathe up and you got to rub your eyes. So, but anyhow, it's one of these things that we got to go through for a while. Let me see. Today is October the 31st. One day closer to the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it's also, I ain't going to say it, 1 month and 29 days. I ain't gonna bring it up, 1 month and 29 days. But I'm going to quit counting, because every time I do, it just wells up inside me, you know. But We got a special day today. We got Darrin Donahue who's going to be here. Right now we need our opening song. And it's going to be number, I ain't got my glasses on.
213.
I can put them on.
Bobby, you want me to help you sit down?
Let's all stand. This is one of my favorite songs. One of my favorites. And you should probably know the words by now. Lift up the trumpet and loud let it ring. Jesus is coming again. Cheer up, ye pilgrim, be joyful and sing. Jesus is coming again. Coming again, Jesus is coming again. Echo in hilltops, proclaim it in plains, Jesus is coming again. Coming in glory, the Lamb that was slain, Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again, Jesus is coming again. Heavings of earth tell the vast wandering throng, Jesus is coming again. Tempest and whirlwind,
the anthem prolong,
Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again, Jesus is coming again. Nations are angry by this, we do know, Jesus is coming again. Knowledge increases, men run to and fro,
Jesus
is coming again. Coming again, coming again,
Jesus is
coming again. Every single verse describes our world today.
Jesus is coming again, and I am so glad. All right. Now it's time for an offering, and the offering today is for Sunnydale Academy. If you want to do that, take a tie envelope and write offering of the day and mark it in. That way the treasurer knows right exactly where it goes, and it goes to there. Okay? So our deacons, please rise there. Our Father in heaven, our Lord Jesus Christ and Holy Spirit, how we praise you again for being such a wonderful, loving God. I praise you, Lord, for the blessings you have given us. And I pray now that as we return this portion to you, that you will bless it, that it will, the monies that are there will go throughout the world, and that the very last person that needs to hear the good news of your soon return will hear it, and you will say in the heavenly sanctuary, it is done, and we're waiting. waiting for that day, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is taken from Romans 13:11. If you'd like to turn there, I'll give you a second. Happy Sabbath, everyone. And you on this side also. We're unbalanced. Romans 13:11. And this is what it says. And that knowing the time that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. May the Lord add his blessing to that. Do we have a silent request for prayer this morning? Yes, everyone. Should be everyone. as many as can, let's kneel and we'll take our petitions to the Lord this morning. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, this morning we come before you thanking you for Jesus, thanking you for life itself, thanking you for the gift of salvation, thanking you that we know your coming is soon, and we look forward to that day when we can be reunited with loved ones. And Father, we pray that you would just bless us today, that you would heal our hearts, that you would open our ears and our eyes and help us to be receptive of the message that will be presented. We pray, Father, that you would send the Holy Spirit in double portion, that we might get ready for what's coming on this earth, and that we might be a witness to those around us in our neighborhoods and our friends and family. And I pray, Father, that you would just be with Darrin's message this morning, that it would touch our hearts, that it would heal us and help us to have strength, that we might go forward with your work that you have given us to do. We pray that you would... We know that you have seen every hand that has been raised. There are things going on in every family. And we pray, Father, that you would be with each family that has come this morning and bless them. And those that couldn't make it, be with those people, Father. And be with all of those on the prayer list and the bulletin, those that are suffering and that need your special blessing, that need your comfort, that need your healing. And Father, we pray that you would make this a holy and sacred time and help us to look to Jesus each and every day, each and every minute, and help us to know that he is the life giver and we want to be ready when he comes. Thank you for all the things that you do. Cover our sins this morning. We ask it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Incline thy ear to us and grant us thy peace. Amen.
All right, now we're going to have a special music, and it's going to be Brother Carl Brown is going to give us a blessing in song.
One pair of hands formed the mountains. One pair of hands formed the sea. One pair of hands made the sun and the moon, every bird, every flower, every tree. One pair of hands formed the valleys, the ocean, the rivers, and the sand. Those hands are so strong, so when life goes wrong, put your faith into one pair of hands. One pair of hands healed the sick. One pair of hands raised the dead. One pair of hands calmed the raging storm, and thousands of people were fed. One pair of hands said, I love you. Hands were nailed to a tree. Those hands are so strong, so when life goes wrong, put your faith into one pair of hands. Hands are so strong, so when life goes wrong, put your faith into one pair of hands. Put your faith into one pair of hands. One pair of hands.
Darrin Donahue.
Can I get the lapel mic? I should have stopped by and gotten it. I didn't. All right, we'll see how this works. Pray for me. I don't knock my water over. Oh, you're good. You're good. I'll stall for time, don't worry.
Yeah, stall for time. due to the, a lot of circumstances, we're not going to have the work day tomorrow. We'll reschedule it for later on this month, okay? Next month.
Brothers and sisters, and am I on? Is this all set up okay? Okay, good, good. I can't fit my water under here, so you might pray that I don't knock it off and ruin your sound system. Let's pray. Father, what a blessing as always to be in your house. We are so thankful to be in your house. Lord, we just pray, help us draw closer to you. Grant me the words to say in Jesus' name, amen. Open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 13. Genesis 13. And also, I always have to put in a plug for our radio. Please pray for our radio program. We'd appreciate it if you'd pray for our radio. The title of the message today is The Warning. It's The Warning. Okay. And some of the verses you'll turn to, and some of them are on the list of Bible verses that they handed out. I think they've got more if you didn't get a sheet. But Genesis 13 and verse 13. And the Bible says here, "But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly." Most of us know the story of Sodom and Gomorrah, how sinful and wicked the people were. And the Bible says here that they were sinners before the Lord exceedingly. They were such bad sinners that God said, "I have to destroy these people. I have to take these people out." And most of us, we probably know the story of Lot and what happened with the men coming around and surrounding their house. But sometimes we kind of think, well, the ladies are a little more tender-hearted. Ladies aren't quite so bad. But then we remember the story of Lot's daughters and what happened with them, and they were sinners. The Bible is very clear, they were sinners before the Lord exceedingly. In Genesis 19, please turn there, 24 and 25, the Bible continues and says, speaking of Sodom and Gomorrah, Genesis 19, 24 and 25, "Then the Lord rained upon Sodom and upon Gomorrah brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven. And he overthrew those cities and all the plain and all the inhabitants of the cities and that which grew upon the ground." They were such terrible sinners that God said, "I have to destroy these cities. I can't let these people continue. I have to destroy these cities." And even though Abraham lobbied hard to save them, God couldn't save them. He had to destroy them. And as you read through the Bible and you read the story, it kind of sounds like maybe it just happened so quickly. God just said, "They're just terrible, and I'm just going to have to take them out." But was it really that fast? Well, on your sheet there, Ezekiel 33:11, God says, "Say unto them, as I live, saith the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn ye from your evil ways. For why will you die, O house of Israel?" God was not saying, "I can't wait to get my hands on these sinners." God was not saying, "I just want to take these guys out." But God is love. God is mercy. He takes no pleasure in the death of unbelievers. He takes no pleasure in having to destroy people and keep them out of heaven. You may have heard back in colonial America some 400 years ago, there was a really famous sermon that was given, and it was titled, "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." And this pastor, he just went into great detail how God was going to burn sinners throughout all eternity and boil and bake sinners. And halfway through the sermon, people are crying out, "We've heard enough, that's enough, stop." At the end of the sermon, when he gave an altar call, People came running down front, He got a lot of conversions to the church. I don't know how many of those people be in heaven, but he got a lot of people into the church. Is that how God is? Now, I can't wait to burn these people. Well, the Bible tells us here in 1 Timothy 2:4, who will have all men to be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. We read of God's great love. He'll have all men to be saved. He'll have all people to be saved. He wants people in heaven. He wants people to have eternal life. He wants people to live forever. That's God's will. That's God's plan. That is ultimately what God is all about. Now, none of us enjoy disciplining our children, but there's times when we have to do it, and that's how God is. Actually, when you put everything together, you find God gave Sodom and Gomorrah a great warning. He actually gave them a great, great warning. In Genesis 14, verse 1 and 2. Genesis 14, verse 1 and 2. The Bible says, and it came to pass in the days of Amramphel, king of Shinar, Arioch, king of Eleazar, Chedorlaomer, king of Elam, and Tidal, king of nations, that these made war with Bera, king of Sodom, and with Bersha, king of Gomorrah, Shinab, king of Admah, and Shemeber, king of Zeboam, and the king of Bela, which is Zorah. History tells us that at this point in time, that Elam was a very powerful nation. And we now know that the Elamites had spread out and they had actually conquered all the Middle East. They had conquered all the Bible lands. So when Abraham came into Palestine, Elam actually owned the area. That was kind of their domain. They had spread out. But at some point in time, the kings of Sodom, Gomorrah, and a few others, they decide we're tired of serving these guys. Now, we're tired of paying taxes, tired of giving them more money. We're not going to do that anymore. So after a short time, the king of Elam said, well, we'll see about that. And he got his rivals, or he got his allies together, and they marched into the Middle East. And when you read Genesis 14, you find the exact route that they followed is an exact route that invaders would have had to have followed in that time. Some people say, well, the Bible's just made up. It's just fairy tales, a bunch of stories. But somebody was there. Somebody saw exactly what happened and they wrote it down. This is no fairy tale. This really happened. In Genesis 14, 8 and then 10 and 11. And there went out the king of Sodom and the king of Gomorrah and the king of Admah and the king of Zeboam and the king of Bela, the same as Zoar, and they joined battle with them in the vale of Siddim. Verse 10, and the vale of Siddim was full of slime pits, and the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled and fell there. And they that remained fled to the mountain. And they took all the goods of Sodom and Gomorrah and all their victuals and went their way. What we have here is four nations joining their forces, invading against five cities. So you got four nations against five cities, and of course the four nations won. And it was such a decisive defeat that the armies of Sodom and Gomorrah just scattered. So there's nobody left to defend the city. So the invaders just march right into the city and they take everything. And the Bible says it was very wealthy. So they take the gold, the silver, the jewels, all the food, all the wheat, and they take all the people. Well, they made a mistake because they took Lot, Abraham's nephew. And then they took all this stuff and they just went on their way. And of course, confident of victory, they're not expecting any problems. But Abraham, when he hears of this, he gathers his forces and they march against Elam. And they hit them and they attack them when they're not ready, and God gives them a great victory. So Abraham then gathers up all the gold, the silver, the people, everything, and he starts to return. According to the rules, so to speak, of warfare in those days, Abraham now owns everything. All the gold is his. All the people are his. All the wheat is his. The king of Sodom, he comes out and he says, you know, I really appreciate what you've done. Can I have my people back? And Abraham says, here, you can take your people. In fact, you can take everything. I don't want anything from you. I don't want anybody saying that you have made me rich. I want people knowing God has made me rich. The God of heaven, he's the one who's made me rich. Well, the people of Sodom and Gomorrah were just shocked when they heard this. They never heard anything like this. You know, they were so proud and selfish and mean, they would have gladly taken it all. For somebody to say, I don't want this, I'm more worried about my God than myself, it was an eye-opener to them. Absolute shock to them. And then the fact that Abraham won the battle after he was greatly outnumbered anyway, they thought, there's something here. You know, this God is real. They were given a great, great warning, you better repent of your sins because next time you won't have a Savior. They were given a great warning, you know, the God of heaven is watching, you better repent of your sins. Did they repent of their sins? I don't think they did. They didn't learn their lessons. Genesis 6 and verse 3. And again, we're in the warning. Title of the message today is The Warning. Genesis 6:3. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh. Yet his days shall be 120 years. You might remember the flood of Noah. You probably personally don't remember it, but the Bible talks all about it. And what was happening in Sodom and Gomorrah was happening on a worldwide scale. The whole world was sinners exceedingly before the Lord. And God said, I have to take action. But again, God is so long-suffering and merciful, he wanted to save souls. So he sends Noah, and the Bible says he's a preacher of righteousness. And Noah begins to build this big ark, and he begins to preach and teach and warn the people, you got to repent of your sins. Well, most people just laughed at him. They said, yeah, rain, yeah, right. God bringing judgment, yeah, right. And right before the flood, just a few days, week or so before the flood, all of a sudden a great sign happened. Just out of nowhere, the animals start to line up. They come out of the hills and the mountains and the valleys. Nobody's leading them. Nobody's bringing them along. Of their own accord, two by two of the unclean and sevens of the clean, and they just come up to the ark, and they just march into the ark. It was a great sign. It was a great sign to the people. Did they listen? Did they take to heart? They were given a great warning, and they just rejected it. You might remember Nineveh, Jonah and the whale, the story of Jonah and the whale. Nineveh was sinners exceedingly before the Lord, 120,000 people at least. And God said, Jonah, you need to go to these people. Well, eventually Jonah went, and they all repented. They took to heart the warning. They turned to God. They were forgiven of their sins, and we're going to see these people in heaven. They were given a great warning, and they listened. They listened. So what about today? On your sheet for a while here, 2 Timothy 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1 to 4. The Bible says, this know also that in the last days, today, perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, you know, putting self first. And then Paul goes on and says, covetous and boasters, proud and blasphemers, and then down to verse 4, traitors, heady, high-minded. Paul talks about today, and he goes overboard trying to impress upon us how sinful and wicked the people are today. And most of us would kind of look around and say, yeah, he's right. You know, those great sinners out there. But he doesn't stop there. He continues verse 4 and verse 5. He says, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. Paul is not talking about the sinners. He's talking about the saints. He's not talking about those outside of the church. He's talking about the churches in general. He says we're in perilous times because the churches of today, just like the world, just like the world, it's just a form of godliness to most Christians. They're just going through the motions. It's not real. It's not from the heart. They have not made a complete surrender to Jesus Christ. Sometimes, how could the mark of the beast ever be passed? How could it ever be passed? Well, it's simple. When for most people they're just going through the motions, it's going to be easy. It's going to be easy to be passed. You see, for most professing Christians, now I'm including all churches, you know, not just ours, all churches, it's the just shall live by faith, so it doesn't matter how I live. I believe in Jesus. I believe in Jesus. I don't have to keep Sabbath. You know, I love God. I love God. Well, who cares how I live? I can live how I want because I got faith. I believe. But what does Jesus say? John 14, 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. He's looking for committed people. He's looking for surrendered people. He's looking for people who love him more than anything and have given their heart to him and their life to him and are committed to him. That's what he's looking for. Turn to Matthew 24. Matthew 24. We're going to spend a little time in Matthew 24 and Matthew 25. Matthew 24 and verse 4 and 5, talking about the warning. The warning. Jesus tells us here in Matthew 24, verse 4 and 5, and we can believe Jesus. You know, we can trust the words of Jesus. Of course, we can trust the whole Bible, of course. Verse 4 and 5. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Jesus warns us right at the end of time. People are going to appear pointing to him. He's Christ. He's Savior. He's Messiah. And many are going to be deceived. They're going to lead people astray. They're going to point to Jesus, but ultimately it's all about self. They're going to talk about Jesus, but ultimately it's all about me. It's all about self. He tells us here, false prophet. False prophets. We have to watch out for false prophets. Now, false prophets in the Methodist church, that's not a problem for us. They're not going to bother us. False prophets in the Baptist church, that's not a problem for us. They're not going to bother us. Now, Benny Hinn, people like that, they're not going to bother us. What about false prophets in our own church? What about false pastors in our church? What about false conference presidents in our church? All of a sudden, that's a problem. All of a sudden, that could be a problem for us. We got to know the Bible for ourselves. We got to know the Scriptures for ourselves. We've got to be able to dig into the Word of God and know this is what God says. This is how He wants me to live. This is what I need to do. In 2 Thessalonians, that should be on your sheet, verse 2, 2 Thessalonians 2, verses 8 and 9. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders. We are warned that we will see, if we haven't seen them already, signs and wonders and lying wonders, real miracles. Real miracles, not just technology tricks, but real undeniable miracles. And many are going to say, we saw that miracle, this person's from God. We saw a real, honest, true sign. God's got to be speaking. God's got to be working. But they're not from God. But what they teach does not match the Scriptures. He continues, 10 to 12, and says, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. He says we have to believe the truth enough to do it. A lot of people believe the truth, but who's willing to do it? Who's willing to put it into practice? Who's willing to commit their heart to Christ no matter what? Who's willing to stick by Jesus when the times get tough? Who's willing to stick by Him no matter what they say, think, or do to us? That's the true Christian. That's the true born-again Christian. Matthew 24, 6 and 7. Jesus continues and says, "And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom." Jesus gives us a list of signs, and a lot of people look at these and read these and say, "Well, how can these be signs? We've always had this. We've always had wars. We've always had threatenings. We've always had rumors of wars." But in 1914, everything changed. For the first time in history, we had things on a worldwide scale. Previous to that, it was never on a worldwide scale. 1914, we had World War I. Then right after that, we had the Spanish flu that killed like 60 million people. Then we had the great economic depression of those days. And then all of a sudden, we had World War II. The whole world was in chaos, complete shakeup. Signs were getting close. Wonders here, we're getting close. He continues, verse 7, "And there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places." Have we seen famines? Yeah, we've seen famines. Are we going to see a worldwide famine? Are we going to see a worldwide crop failure? And then he says pestilence, disease, COVID. Now everybody knows COVID's real. But for the first time in history, they're shutting the world down. Why are they shutting the world down? You might remember, well, you probably don't remember. I don't remember. But back during the Spanish flu, 50, 60 million people died. They didn't shut the world down. Back several years ago, polio, they didn't shut the world down. Why are they all of a sudden shutting the world down? You know, they told us 85% of the world was going to get COVID. It's been more like 2%. You know, they predicted millions of deaths. Nobody really knows how many people have died from COVID. In case you're not aware, my sister-in-law is a nurse. She had some friends who got COVID. They died a few days later in a traffic accident. Guess what the official cause of death was? Yeah, it was COVID. Nobody knows how many people really are dying. Why are they shutting the world down? We're Seventh-day Adventists. We've read Revelation 13. We know what's going on. Are they practicing? Earthquakes. Jesus here talks about earthquakes. Now I assume that he means other natural disasters. We've seen more hurricanes already. Record number of hurricanes. We just had another one here. Are we getting close? Are we seeing signs? On your sheet is a great quote from Ellen White from The Great Controversy, page 594. I'm going to read it, and then there's a couple points I really want to make from this. It says, "The dignitaries of church and state will unite to bribe, persuade, or compel all classes to honor the Sunday. The lack of divine authority will be supplied by oppressive enactments. Political corruption is destroying love of justice and regard for truth. And even in free America, rulers and legislators, in order to secure public favor, will yield to the popular demand for a law enforcing Sunday observance." Okay, I want to point a few things out in this quote. I think I've underlined them. In the first sentence there, it says, "Dignitaries of church and state will unite to bribe, persuade, or compel." Some people are going to be bribed. Now I can imagine, okay, I'm just imagining this. Conference presidents are going to be bribed. Tell your people to go along with this, we'll slip you some money under the table. Tell your people to go along with this, we'll give you a nice job over here. And then others, it says here, persuade. Everybody's doing this, you guys need to go along. Everybody's involved, look at this Bible verse, it's okay. And then finally, compel or force. I mean, we know ultimately they're going to force. And then it says, second sentence, even in free America, rulers and legislators. Now, who's rulers and legislators? What's that? President, Congress, yeah, government, yeah, absolutely. In order to secure public favor, will yield to the popular demand for a law enforcing Sunday observance. Now, I point this out because over the years I've heard people say, watch out for martial law. Because if they have martial law, then they can pass the mark of the beast. Well, that's not how it's going to happen. When you look at this quote very carefully, rulers and legislators, president, lawmakers of government, in order to secure public favor. Now, when you're in martial law, you don't care about public favor. You got tanks in the street. You got the National Guard out in every state. You don't care what the people think. But if you want to be reelected, if you want people to contribute to your campaign, you care what they think. And then it says, to secure public favor will yield to the popular demand for the law. This isn't something that is forced on us from the top down. This is something everybody's calling for. It's the popular demand. Now, again, I'm thinking here in my mind, I'm thinking today, society is just so polarized, so split. Liberals and Democrats and rich and poor and all these things happening. But everybody's going to pull together for this. Everybody's going to say, okay, we agree on this. This is something we all can agree on in order to secure public favor. Back at Kansas City Central a number of years ago, we had a religious liberty director, and he used to stand up and say, I'm voting for the Democrats because they're less likely to pass the mark of the beast. And I had to say, look at this quote, brother. You know, when it all comes down to it, everybody's going to get involved. Republicans, Democrats, black, white, rich, poor, everybody's going to be behind this. It's not going to be forced from the top down. Now, again, in my own mind, I'm thinking about COVID. They're practicing how to shut the world down. You can't come in our store unless you wear a mask. You can't come in our store unless you got the mark of the beast. You can't buy from us unless we know you're healthy. Can't buy from us unless you have the mark of the beast. I mean, I see them practicing. You know, we're Seventh-day Adventists. We know what's coming. We shouldn't be shocked at all this. It's getting close. I think, we're just a few earthquakes away from things kicking off. It's possible we're in the warning time. Just like God was warning Sodom and Gomorrah. Just like during the time of Noah, he was warning them. Just like in the time of Nineveh, he was warning them. We're given a warning. Are we going to listen? Are we going to heed the warning? In Matthew 25, turn to Matthew 25. We're going to spend some time there in Matthew 25. Probably just turn a page. Matthew 25, verse 1 and 2. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise and 5 of them were foolish. Jesus tells a parable of the church at the end of time. And they're all going forth to meet Jesus. They're all expecting the return of Jesus. Some are wise, some are foolish. Some are lost, some are saved. And then verse 3 to 5. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. The foolish knew Jesus was returning. They knew Jesus was returning, but they lacked oil. They lacked faith. They lacked commitment to love and serve Jesus Christ. They had enough oil to start the lamp, but they didn't have enough oil to keep it burning. They had enough faith to come to church when it was easy, when there was no consequences, but they didn't have enough faith when times got bad, when times got hard. Jesus says here, the entire church is asleep. The entire church is asleep. And he says it's time to wake up. He says it's time for his people to wake up. He says it's time for his people to commit their heart, commit their life, commit their all unto him. We serve a great God. We serve a great Savior. He loves his people. He's telling us it's time to wake up, time to be committed, time to give our all to him. In verse 6, and at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. The time has come for Jesus' return, and he says it's time for his people to shine. It's time for his people to shine for him, to really be on fire for him, to really be committed and surrendered to him. Unfortunately, some here discover it's just a profession. I've just been going through the motions the whole time. And he says it's time to be committed, time to be surrendered. We're supposed to be given the cry. We can't give it if we're not committed. We can't warn others if we're not surrendered to him. Job and his wife. Now, you might remember Job and his wife. They're a perfect example of this. They both basically lost all their money. They both lost most of their property. They both lost all their kids. And when things got really bad, Job stood, and his wife said, curse God and die. How many Christians are just half-hearted? How many are just going through the motions? How many have enough faith to be here on Sabbath day, but when times get bad, are we still going to be here? And when times get tough, are we still going to be committed to Jesus? That's what he's looking for. People who love him, people who serve him, people who are committed to him. In verse 10, and while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage. And the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgin, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, verily I say unto you, I know you not. They thought they had time. They thought they had plenty of time. They thought that they would see these things, and then they would have time to get ready. And they found out they had been delaying. And delaying and delaying and delaying too long. And Jesus says, it's time. It's time to be committed to him. It's time to be surrendered to him. It's time to give our all to him. In Romans 13, 11, and we'll be on the sheet for a little bit here. And that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. Jesus says, it's high time to wake out of sleep. Our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. We may be talking months now instead of years. 1 Corinthians 15, 34. Awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. He wants us to be serious about serving him, serious about loving him, serious about obeying him. Praying, what do you want me to do, Lord? Where do you want me to go, Lord? How can I serve you today, Lord? How can I follow you? How can I love you more, Lord? He wants his people serious about him. Ephesians 5:14. Wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepest and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. We can do it. We can do it through his strength. We can do it through his power. We can do it by linking up with him and committing our all to him. We can do it. There's no reason for any of us to be lost. There's no reason for any of our lights to go out. If we choose to love and serve Him, we can be following Him. We can be absolutely committed, absolute loving and serving Him. In Jonah 1:6. So the shipmaster came to him and said unto him, What meanest thou, O sleeper? Arise, call upon thy God, if so be that God will think upon us that we perish not. He says, arise and call on God, and keep calling, and keep calling, and keep calling. When life is hard, keep calling. When life is really difficult, keep calling. When you get tempted, keep calling. Keep calling on Him. He's there to help His children. And finally, Isaiah 60, verse 1. Arise and shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. He calls His people to arise and shine for Him. Shine for Jesus. Asking the Lord, what can I do for you? Praying to the Lord, use me. Work through me. Help me be committed to you, Lord. Help me be dedicated to you. Help me give my all to you. So what do we do? What can we do to wake up? What can I do? Well, I've outlined a few things here as we close. In Romans 10, 17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The first thing we need to do is be into Bible study. Every day open the Bible. Every day reading the word. We may have to turn off the TV. We may have to shut down the internet for a bit. But take time every day to get into God's word. 30 minutes a day, an hour a day. Just read. Just read. Some parts of it are really easy to read. Genesis, that's really easy. 1 Samuel and on. The stories in the Bible are really easy. Just read them and think about them. Okay, don't just read them like a novel, but think about them. What can I learn here? What lesson can I get here? And then second is prayer. Praying to our God every day. In Proverbs 15:8. The sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but the prayer of the upright is His delight. God loves to hear from you. It's God's delight when we talk to Him. It's God's delight when we're praying to Him. Proverbs 15:29. The Lord is far from the wicked, but He heareth the prayer of the righteous. He hears our prayers. The devil tries to tempt us. God's not listening. Devil tries to tempt us. God doesn't care. Bible says He hears the prayer of the righteous. He hears every prayer. He hears every sincere prayer. He is in the business of answering and helping. Now, of course, I'm not saying you're going to get everything you want, but we take it to Him in prayer, trusting He knows better than I do. In Proverbs 28:13, the next thing to do, he that covereth his sin shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Repent of our sins. When we're doing things we know we shouldn't be doing, let's take it to Him in prayer. Let's confess to Him. Let's ask for forgiveness. Let's ask for mercy, and let's ask for help not to do it again. And let's strive through His help and His strength not to do it again. We confess our sins. Now, sometimes you may have to go to somebody and confess your sins to them too, but we confess to God first and foremost. And finally here, our last verse. Habakkuk 3:17. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vine, the labor of the olive shall fail, and the field shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stalls. Yet will I rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like hinds' feet. He will make me to walk upon mine high places. This is where we need to be. Though we don't have enough to eat, though we don't have enough to drink, though we see all kinds of threats in the land, we're going to be faithful. We're going to be committed. We're going to love and serve Him. As we have our closing song here, if you're thinking, you know, I need a little extra prayer. If you're thinking, I need to recommit my life to the Lord. If you're thinking, I need help, I need strength, come down front. And as we have closing prayer, we'll pray especially for you.
I think we all need that extra special prayer. Let's turn to 432. Stand.
Shall we gather at the river where bright angel feet have trod with its crystal tide forever? Yes, we'll gather at the river. The beautiful, the river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God.
If you'd like special prayer, please come down front.
Ere we reach the shining river, lay we every burden. Yes, we'll
gather at the river, the
beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Soon we'll reach the shining river.
If there's anybody else who would like to come down front, let's pray. Father, we want to thank you that Jesus is returning shortly, very soon, and we thank you for the warnings that you've given us. Father, we pray for all of us. Help us be completely committed to you. Lord, we especially pray for those who've come down front. You know the needs, you know the struggles. We pray for them. Father, we lift up our united voices here on their behalf. Father, please work mightily in their lives. Work mightily in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.